Hi everyone, so today we will study another lecture of VSR, Veterinary Surgery and Radiology courses, Principles of Surgery. Okay, this is a very small chapter. This is not so much important from theoretical point of view, but from practical point of view, this is very important. If you want to be a good surgeon or clinician, you should know this. Okay. It is for surgical patient, but it can be applied to all type of patients. Okay, so chapter is preoperative care of surgical patient. First of all, the most important thing is history taking. Okay, so which points you need to consider while taking history? First one is signalment. It means from when the disease has started. Okay, so from when the animal has shown the symptoms, etc. This is known as signalment. Next one is diet. Okay, so for the animal's normal diet is, suppose if you know the diet, okay, what he or she has been eating, then you can know the nutritional status. Okay, so from that you can give a guarantee on wound healing. Okay, if the animal is in commercial diet, which is basically a balanced diet, the wound healing will be faster. Okay, so the diet is also important. Also, this is also important during surgery. Okay, so before surgery you should have a fasting. I will discuss on later. So diet is important. Next one is exercise. Okay, whether the animal is getting sufficient exercise or not. Okay, because in some cases, if you are doing some abdominal surgery or fracture immobilization, so this needs to be reduced. The exercise needs to be reduced. So you should know whether the animal is going on exercise or not. Next, environment. Some animals are kept in air conditioned rooms. You remember, most of the dogs which are kept in air conditioned rooms, they will have some skin problems. Okay, so you should know this, which environment they are keeping in, whether it is normal room ambient temperature or in an air conditioned room. Okay, next, past medical problems, whether the dog has been previous history of similar diseases or any other diseases. Okay, so you have to take history regarding past medical problem. Next, recent treatments. Recently, within 1 to 2 months or past 1 to 2 months, whether the dog has a cat or even if a large animal has gone any treatments or any medications that animal is currently in. Next one is previous drug reactions. Okay, you see, this is very important. Because I can give you an example. I have a dog in which if you give doxycycline, the animal will show reaction to the doxycycline. So you should know, most of the pet parents or animal owners, they don't know this, but you have to be vigilant enough, or you have to give some idea regarding drug reaction, so they can tell you that which drugs are reactive to the animal or reactive to the body. Next one is, second is physical examination. This one is very important. First one, you have to examine the general body conditions. It means you have to examine the mental status. Okay. Then body condition. Body condition is whether the animal is thin, moribund, or obese, overweight, like that. Okay, so you have to do mental status, whether the animal is alert or depressed. Next, you can go for any abnormal gestures. Okay, in case of urinary bladder rupture, in case of goats, you will find they will keep their hind leg extended to the posterior side or caudal side. Okay, so you may find these abnormal gestures, or like in milk fever, you will find the animal will be sleeping with his head on its belly. So these are basically the general body condition. Next, you have to evaluate the systems, different systems. Most important, these two, the cardiovascular and respiratory system. You have to measure the in cardiovascular heart rate, pulse rate. Okay, in respiratory, the respiration rate. Okay, so these you have to measure and observe closely. And in cardiovascular, you have to check for arrhythmia also. Okay, next gastrointestinal, whether the system has any foreign body or anything, any history, any examination you have to do, you need to monitor it closely. Okay, gastrointestinal, then urogenital, whether there is bladder problem, urethra problem, any other thing, urogenital system, next skeletal system, whether there is any fracture or dislocation, these are skeletal, fracture or dislocation. Next, you have to examine nervous system. You see most of the cases, in case of cats bitten by dog, you will find most of the cases of posterior paraplegia. In that case, you have to check the nervous system, whether the nerve transmission is there or not, any reflex is there or not. You have to check thoroughly the nervous system. So this is physical examination. After the physical examination, you have to give the rating from 1 to B. Regarding this rating, I have already made a video. I think it was small animal anesthesia. I will give link in the description, or you can find it in playlist. Okay, in anesthesia playlist, I have set the conditions of classification from category 1 to category 5. Next one is clinical examination. Okay, so in clinical examination, you have to go for hematology or serum biochemistry and also diagnostic imaging. So hematology and serum biochemistry, you have to go for like CBC. Under CBC, you measure the hemoglobin, differential count, TLC, total leukocyte count, TEC, total erythrocyte count, PCB, packed volume. There is also MCHC, mean concentration, hemoglobin concentration, mean cell hemoglobin concentration. Then there is other parameters also, not so important. These 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. These 5 are very important. Next is blood parasites. Okay, you see, in case of dog, you have to go for diphtheria, also babesia. In case of large animals, you have to go with theileria or trypanosoma or babesia, like that. All the blood parasite should be monitored and checked. In case of canines, we may find Ehrlichia canis infection. Okay, so these can be diagnosed from blood parasite examination. Then LFT, a liver function test, you have to go for the enzymes ALT, AST and ALP. These three enzymes are liver enzymes. Next is kidney function test, in which you have to measure the biliary, blood, urea, nitrogen. Next, creatinine. Okay, these are all examination, clinical examination, specifically the hematology and serum biochemistry. Apart from these, you can also measure the some iron concentrations, okay, like sodium, potassium, chloride. Okay, these can be measured if you have the facility. Okay, then you can measure these. Also, you can measure the carbon dioxide concentration, CO2 concentration, whether there is hypercapnia or hypocapnia. So this is all about the hematology and serum biochemistry. Next, coming to the diagnostic imaging, we can go for radiograph or ultrasonography. Okay, so in ultrasonography, mostly if the emergency cases, we use a technique known as FAST, F-A-S-T. Okay, it is focused assessment with sonography for trauma. I will discuss the FAST when I will go for diagnostic surgery. Okay, so these are the diagnostic imaging. If you have taken the history, done the physical examination and clinical examination, 99% of cases will be solved. Okay, this is for surgical patient, but this is also applied to the clinical patient. Any medicinal case also, if you have done all these, okay, 99% cases you will diagnose the disease correctly. Okay, but this is very important when you are going for surgery. So this you have to keep it beforehand. Okay, so you see, in some colleges or some institutions, you may not find all these things. So it is your duty, you can make them aware, or you have to aware the hospital regarding this. You can make a sheet. Okay, you can make a sheet with these points, so that when you look at the sheets, after looking all these parameters, you will find the diagnosis very, very, very easy. Okay. Some other points regarding the preoperative care of surgical patient. This one is very important when you are dealing with surgical patient. The client communication. फर्स्ट वन इज द डायग्नोसिस. यू हैव टू टेल योर ओनर व्हिच डिजीज और व्हिच कंडीशन हैज बीन डायग्नोस्ड. नेक्स्ट सर्जिकल और नॉन सर्जिकल ऑप्शंस. फॉर एग्जांपल इफ द एनिमल इज सफरिंग फ्रॉम फर्स्ट डिग्री पायमेट्रा देन यू कैन गो फॉर नॉन सर्जिकल ऑप्शंस लाइक मेडिसिन एंड ट्रीटमेंट्स. बट इफ द एनिमल इज going through the third degree pyometra, then only the surgical option remains. Okay, so you have to tell your patient so what are the surgical and non-surgical options. Non-surgical basically the medicinal options. Next, potential complications. Okay, in there will be some cases in which you will find the uterine rupture cases. For example, I am telling uterine rupture cases. In that case, you may find the peritonitis as a potential complication. So you have to tell your owner regarding the complications. This is very important, okay, because the owner will not understand what is actually going on. Okay, if you won't tell him or her, he will not understand or she will not understand, and he or she can blame you in future. So you have to tell clear cut about the potential complications. Next, post-operative care. Suppose you have done a laparotomy wound, for that you need to take care of the wound for nearly 6 to 7 days minimum. Okay, so you have to tell that to the owner if the animal has gone with the GI surgery, whether it is gastrotomy or enterotomy, then for 1 to 2 days, 24 to 48 hours, sometimes up to 72 hours, the animal won't take any oral food. All the medications will be through intravenous route. So you have to tell your owner regarding the post-operative care. Next, prognosis. Whether the prognosis is favorable or guarded or poor, okay, you have to tell your patient. Suppose a uterine rupture case which has been presented after 24 hours, the prognosis is poor. Okay, most of the time prognosis is poor. So you have to tell your owners. And in case of third degree pyometra, when the cases will be present after 48 hours or 72 hours, after the animal has stopped taking food or anorexia develops, the most of the time it will be under guarded, or even some cases it will go for poor prognosis. So you have to tell your owner. This is very important. Cost. Okay, many of the pet owners or livestock owners, they don't know that there is cost involvement also. Okay, so they think everything is free or everything is of less cost. Okay, even if C-section in dog, if you will go for the sterile procedures, it can cost up to 5,000 rupees or 6,000 rupees. Okay, so you have to tell your owner regarding cost. You can include your veterinarian fee or any other fee if you have. Then by including, you have to inform the client beforehand, not during the procedure or after the procedure. You may be cheated. Next, the patient stabilization. You see, fluid therapy, I have already discussed in detail. You have to go through the VSR playlist. There I have given the shock pathophysiology and the fluid therapy. So I am not discussing regarding fluid therapy. Next is oxygen therapy. If the patient develops hypoxia, then you have to give oxygen therapy. Now you must be knowing in corona cases. Okay. So hypoxia, the signs of hypoxia mostly is dyspnea, tachycardia. These two are very prominent signs. Apart from this, you can go for pulse oximetry, which you are doing in humans. Okay, by this you can know the oxygen requirement. Okay, so these are some methods by which the oxygen is delivered to the patient. First one is flow by. What does the flow by mean? Suppose this is face of an animal. Okay, so flow by means you have to, this is oxygen outlet. So the outlet will be placed just in front of the head. Okay, so the oxygen will flow like towards the nose. This is flow by. Let us understand the modes, then I will discuss the flow rate. Next is face mask. Face mask means here will be a mask. Okay, this will be mask. Sometimes some conscious patients, they resist to the mask. So you can go for, this is collar canopy or otherwise known as Elizabethan collar canopy. Okay, this is alternate for the face mask. In that case, suppose this is a patient. Okay, you know Elizabethan collar, it will be placed like this. So what they do, they will do some additional covering like this, okay, which will be fitted to the oxygen tube. This is Elizabethan collar canopy. Next, nasal catheter. You may have seen some movies, okay, like Dil Bechara, if you have watched, there is a catheter like small pipe with two catheters inserting into the nose, okay, so that is nasal catheter, okay. So in case of pets also, you can do the same, the nasal catheter. For this, most of the time the animal need to be sedated, okay. Next, intratracheal catheter or tracheostomy. By tracheostomy, you can also deliver the oxygen up to the lungs. Next one is oxygen cage. Okay, this is very popular in case of neonates. Okay, newborn puppies or puppies, there will be cage which will be fitted to the oxygen cylinder. Inside the cage, okay, the oxygen will be provided, in which the animal will be there. Now, next coming to the flow rates. Okay, by flow by, you the flow rate is 6 to 8 liter per minute. This is fraction of inspired oxygen. If you are giving some amount of oxygen, how much percentage is going to be inspired? That is 25 to 45%. This is actually very less, because most of the oxygen will be wasted out. Okay, this is for short term delivery. Okay, next, face mask. Flow rate is nearly same, 6 to 10 liter per minute, and here say there is slight improvement of fraction of inspired oxygen, because there is a closed container, closed system. This is also a short term delivery system. Next, the collar canopy. Okay, you see the flow rate is little bit less, because you see you have made this, okay, this is mostly very thin plastic. If you are providing high flow rate, it may rupture. So the flow rate is very less, but this is a much better closed system than this. That is why it has a fair fraction of inspired oxygen, and this is alternative to the flow mask. So this is also for short term. Next, the nasal catheter. There is a this is 50 to 100 ml per kg per minute. Okay, so the fraction of inspired oxygen is 25 to 40%. This is for long term treatment. If the animal is admitted to your hospital, then for long term treatment you can go for nasal catheter. Next, intratracheal catheter. This is the best for delivery of oxygen, but this should be performed in emergency. So the flow rate is 50 ml per kg per minute. This is the highest, you can see fraction of inspired oxygen 40 to 60%. This is a long term treatment. This is practiced when there is upper airway obstruction, otherwise this is not performed. Okay. Next, last one, oxygen cage. There is no flow rate, because it is a cage where the oxygen is there. So it is also having high FiO, 40 to 50%. This is a long term oxygen delivery system. The thing is, you have very limited access to the patient, because it is inside the case, so you cannot manipulate the patient. So restricted access. Okay, next, the last one is the dietary restriction. If after all this you have decided to go for surgery, this is important, dietary restriction. Food is withheld for 6 to 12 hours before the induction of anesthesia. You see, water, most of the books doesn't give importance on, or doesn't support the withdrawal of water. Water should be provided. Next, pediatric, in case of pediatric patients, this food withdrawal is up to 6 hours maximum, because they can develop the hypoglycemia. That is reduction in blood glucose. Okay, so to prevent hypoglycemia, they are fasted up to 6 hours. So this is all about the preoperative care of patient. Another one, excretion. You see, before surgery, you have to evacuate the feces and the urine. Okay, these two are very important, specifically the urine. Okay, sometimes, many of the times you will find the fully distended urinary bladder during intraoperative procedure if you have not the evacuated the urinary bladder. And problem is the urinary bladder will cover maximum of the abdomen. Okay, so it will help hamper in the process of your surgery. So you have to do the evacuation of, sometimes if you are going for rectal surgery or colon surgeries, you have to evacuate the feces. So you have to evacuate the feces and urine. Whether sometimes if you will keep the surgery in the morning shifts, okay, so the animal will urine and defecate in the morning shift before coming to the OT, this is very good. Or if you are doing in other timings, so you have to manually evacuate, okay, you have to manually evacuate feces or urine. Sometimes if for urine you can do the catheterization. I have a video regarding catheterization of urinary bladder, you can check that. Okay, this is all about pre-operative care of the surgical patients. Okay, next class we'll go for the biomaterial and sutures, that is very very important from theory as well as practical point of view. So this is all about pre-operative care of patient, very small class and not so important from theory but very important from practical point of view. Thank you. Bye-bye.